That was a beautiful rendition of Open My Eyes. As you can tell, Trevor's been practicing. I wasn't sure if he was going to make it on stage today or not. He was kind of iffy. So how's everybody doing? Everybody have a good week? Everybody blessed to be here today? I know I am. Does anybody here follow tennis or play tennis? You do not. Okay. Well, I remember back when I was growing up, late 80s, early 90s, you remember Andre Agassi? Mike, you know, that's our era, right? Andre Agassi kind of made it cool to be a tennis player, right? You know, in the past, you know, prior to the 90s, you had John McEnroe and Jimmy Connor. These were, you know, your mainstays and tennis, but Andre Agassi came out and he just looked like this rock star. You know, he had this like heavy metal kind of hair, bright colored, you know, outfit. And for those of you guys who know tennis, it's very much like golf. You know, it's kind of a gentleman's sport where you wear all white. You know, you're not very, you know, flashy or outspoken. But Andre Agassi came out and he was just the opposite of what a gentleman, I guess, exemplifies in this sport. And, you know, he made it to where people wanted to watch tennis. And not just, you know, people who enjoy tennis, but people who don't even watch tennis, especially the women. When he stepped out onto the scene, more women were watching tennis then than any other time, just because of his, I guess, machismo. And so, you know, he became a spokesperson for Canon, the camera company. And the name of the camera that he was the spokesperson for was the Canon Rebel, which kind of suits his image. And you know, his flashiness and his cockiness, That was the image that he portrayed. Now, have you guys ever heard the term image is everything? That term actually came from him. Well, it came from canon, but he's the one that said it. So that phrase will be forever connected with him. And so that's the title of my sermon today. It's called Image is Everything. And, you know, the phrase has been ingrained in many cultures, you know, worldwide, but most noticeably here in America, even more so today than compared to the 90s when this phrase actually came out. So many aspects of our culture can be determined based on image alone. Marketing experts, politicians, media relations, and even churches are using this image culture to draw people to what they want them to believe based on their image. The best demonstration that I could think of that shows how true this is, social media. Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, now TikTok, whatever that is. And even business social media sites like LinkedIn. And it, don't even get me started on dating sites. Those are the worst when it comes to posting what your image is or what you want people to think you are. You know, all of these sites can be and are used to portray an image of oneself. And many times, a false image at that. Many times the image that people are portraying are images of who they want to be, but not who they truly are. It's more of an outer image rather than an inner image, because many times we are judged by our cover and not by our content. Genesis 1:27 says, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them." You know, for the longest, I thought that this meant that by appearance, we are made in his image. Like, we all look alike. Like, we all look like God. When you see me, you see God. When I look at you, I see God. Strictly based off of appearance. And that's what I thought that this verse meant. You know, kind of like when I see, you know, two siblings, like, oh, they look alike. Or even identical twins. Oh, they look alike. They have the same appearance. And it's not until you actually see how they act that you actually start to see the content of that person or the character of that person. The Hebrew word tselem translates to the word image or idol. The word was used many times in reference to not carving tselem, you know, or idols or images to worship. So why would God create man as an image or idol of himself? Now, before I answer that question, we must understand that people today are really not much different from people in ancient times, especially when it comes to idolatry. What do people do nowadays when people become famous? We put them on posters. We put them on billboards. We make, you know, some people get statues, especially if they've done something really good for whatever sports team. Like, you know, down at Staples Center, you have statue of Kareem, statue of Magic, statue of Shaq. You know, Kobe is going to get one too. So, you know, we make statues of all these people. And they become these images or selim that people try to emulate because we idolize them. You see people start to dress like them, talk like them, or even get surgery to look like them. Those are the scary ones right there. The ones that end up looking like Barbie and whatnot. We even have a show called American Idol. The celebrities are a representation of what so many people want to be like. People in ancient times understood representation and the concept of how image represents something for idolatry. You know, I think it's safe to say that paganism did not exist before Adam and Eve were thrown out of Eden. However, after they were thrown out, the world quickly became pagan. The idea of many gods and goddesses planted into our minds by Satan instead of just one God is an easy assumption to make. There really can't just be one God, right? Let's make a cow a god. How can we worship a cow and communicate to it? If we want to communicate with these other gods, we better get something that represents them, such as the golden calf, like in Exodus 32. So with this, man created a religion and based it on idolatry. If you are a person who wants to worship a god or goddess, you would have a statue to represent them. If you didn't have a statue, you didn't feel like you really had a relationship or a connection with this entity. So the image or idol is made for making that god or goddess present in your midst so you can feel connected. Seems a little silly, right? To have a statue to feel connected to God. But hundreds of millions of people still do this today. And this was not the original intention of God. The answer to my earlier question of why would God create man as an image of himself is this. His original intention was to have us as his representative to others in a way that when we interact with others, how we treat the world, we do just as he would. We are God's representatives. We are to represent God by our character. If our character does not reflect God, then we are not reflecting his image. We are not a reflection of his image. In order to know how to reflect God's character, we need to know what it is. Luke 18:19 tells us that God is good. Isaiah 5:16 tells us that God is holy. Matthew 5:48 tells us that God is perfect. 1 John 3:3 tells us that God is pure. Deuteronomy 32:4 says that God is just. John 3:33 tells us that God is true. 1 Corinthians 10:4 tells us that God is spiritual. Jeremiah 23:6 tells us that God is righteous or righteousness. 1 Corinthians 1:9 tells us that God is faithful. 1 John 4:8 tells us that God is love. James 1:17 tells us that God is unchangeable. And Genesis 21:33 tells us that God is everlasting. These are the characteristics that we as believers in Christ are to reflect. This is the image that God intended to create in us. You know, as a child, it's our parents' job to help build our character. They do this by teaching us what is right and what is wrong. But what do they use as their moral ruler as to what is right and what is wrong? As a Christian, the moral ruler is right there in the Ten Commandments, God's law. I know that after potluck, you know, for the afternoon service, there's been the Amazing Bible, Amazing Facts Bible study. So I'm not sure if you guys are on this lesson or not. If you've already passed this lesson, it's actually a good reminder. It's from lesson number 6, which is called Written in Stone. It mentioned that God's law is his character in written form. 1 Timothy 1:18 tells us that the law is good. Romans 7:12 tells us that the law is holy and just. Psalms 19:7 tells us that the law is perfect. Psalm 19:8 tells us the law is pure. Romans 7:14 tells us the law is spiritual. Psalms 119:172 tells us the law is righteousness. Psalms 119:86 tells us the law is faithful. Romans 13:10 tells us the law is love. Matthew 5:18 tells us that the law is unchangeable. And Psalms 111:7 and 8 tells us the law is everlasting. God's law is a law given to us out of his love for us. Ellen White writes in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 34, "The law of love being the foundation of the government of God, the happiness of all intelligent beings depends upon their perfect accord with its great principles of righteousness. God desires from all his creatures the service of love, service that springs from an appreciation of his character. He takes no pleasure in a forced obedience, and to all he grants freedom of will, that they may render him voluntary service. This free will that we are granted is what makes us perfectly imperfect. We stumble, we fail, we are sinners, but he loves us. He hates the sin, but not the sinner. That is why we must repent and ask for forgiveness. When we do this, not only will we be forgiven, but we will be restored in the image that God created us in, which is in his image. As an earthly parent encourages his child to come to him at all times, so the Lord encourages us to lay before him our wants and perplexities, our gratitude and love. Every promise is sure. Jesus is our surety and mediator and has placed at our command every resource that we may have a perfect character." That's from In Heavenly Places, page 18. You know, James 2:8 calls God's law the royal law. This means that God is royalty, which means we as children of God are royalty. Now, did you ever consider that? Did you ever think that you are royalty? You know, ladies, did you ever dream about, you know, finding that Prince Charming and marrying him and becoming a princess? While for those of you who are married, look no further. You are married to royalty, and are a princess married to a prince. And those of you who are single, you too are princes and princesses, because you are children of the king as well. As royalty, our character is to reflect it. There is a specific way royalty conducts themselves. I'm not sure if any of you watch anything that pertains to the royal family, but my mom really enjoys watching things that have to do with them. Ever since I was little, my mom would watch anything whenever they were on TV. And you could see that the way that they conduct themselves. You know, if you ever watch them, from the children all the way to the queen, they all conduct themselves in a proper manner. You know, of course, the little ones, kids will be kids. They'll run around and you know, act like kids. But for the most part, you'll see them all conduct themselves properly. They dress modestly. They have a clean-cut, well-put-together image, and they're very polite. You rarely, if ever at all, see them reprimand each other or their children in public. Same goes for getting angry or arguing in public. Now, this is very peculiar. You know, especially nowadays, we see parents reprimanding their children in public all the time. Some of them not even just yelling at their kids, but really like whooping their kids in public. To see a family or people not do that when their child is acting up is different than what the world shows us today. You know, they don't act like most people that we know. Being of royalty is peculiar. 1 Peter 2:9 tells us, but you, that's all of us, are a chosen generation. We are chosen. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own peculiar people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Ellen White wrote, the children of Israel were to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. Exodus 31:16. You know, the Sabbath has lost none of its meaning. It is still the sign between God and his people, and it will be so forever. Now and ever, we are to stand as a distinct and peculiar people, free from all worldly policy, unembarrassed by confederation with those who have not wisdom to discern the claims of God, so plainly set forth in his law, from our higher calling 345.3. Observing the Sabbath is what separates us from other denominations. It's what makes us peculiar. When we follow God's law, we reflect his character, because the character of God is reflected in God's law, not man's tradition. As Adventists, we consider ourselves to be the remnant church. In the day of judgment, profession must be backed up by our character. The remnant people at the end of time will keep the commandments of God. You know, in the beginning, I mentioned Andre Agassi and the image that he portrayed. You know, this is over 30 years ago. And you can see today that the image is everything persona is what's mainstream today. Sadly, what was once good is bad, and what was bad is now good. So I caution you, just because it's accepted doesn't make it right. The time when Jesus returns is coming, and we must reflect his character. Revelation 22:11 says, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. We can't go along with what mainstream view says is good when it is actually sin. We must claim to the promise of God that we will be filled with his spirit and made to be partakers of the divine nature, overcoming sin and being more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. How many of you want to proclaim that promise today? Are you willing to turn from your sins and give up all for Christ? He is waiting for a people in these last days who will show the world the true character of God, a people who will follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth. That's 144,000. Then you will be pronounced a saint, as Revelation 14:12 says, someone who keeps the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. May we leave here today reflecting the image of God which he has created in us. God bless.
Thank you, Brother Todd, for the nice message. And for our closing song, may I request everyone to set up and open your hymnal on number 316. Live out thy life within me.
Father, as we leave here today, we pray that you pour the Holy Spirit into us. Help us to reflect your character amongst everyone we come in contact with. Give us your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness that we could give to others around us that either have done us wrong or we've done them wrong. We just pray for your character to pour out of us so that people will know your love and will want your love and will accept it and will want to have that character as well. So Lord, as we leave here today, may the benediction of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.